Democrat here, particularly so many young people. It's no secret that in the last couple elections, Republicans have not done as well as young people we should have. And the fact that we have so many young people in this room interested in this project, we have candidates here who are willing to come to a place like Charlottesville, shows that the Republican Party is on the way back to winning back young voters.
That's right.
So yeah, I just want to thank a couple people. I want to thank our two co-sponsors, the Batten School and the Center for Effective Lawmaking. This was an idea back in December, and then we spoke to Batten, and it became very much reality very quickly. They've been tremendous co-sponsors, co-hosts in this meeting, and we're just very thankful for them. The last thing I kind of want to leave you guys with is kind of just, you know, encouraging you to vote. If you're not registered to vote, we want you to be registered to vote. If you're a student, we want you to be registered here in Charlottesville. That's where you're living the majority of the time. We will have people outside Garrett Hall at the conclusion of the debate registering people to vote. You might need to give us a couple seconds to get organized, but we do definitely want that to happen. Then finally, we want everyone in this room to actually use the right to vote once they're registered. So definitely vote in the June 12th primary for one of our fantastic candidates, and then definitely vote again in 224 days in the November election. Who's getting it? So thank you guys so much, and I'd like to turn it over to the Dean of the Frank Batten School Leadership and Public Policy, Allan.
Thank you very much. Republican primary debate for the Commonwealth of Virginia. I'm Allan Stam, Dean of the Batten School, and your host for this event. Those present have joined with us to exchange views and learn more about the candidates vying for the Virginia Republican nomination for the United States Senate. Let me state for the record the ground rules we agreed to in an effort to advance the public interest in such a conversation. The Batten School has held dozens of discussions with elected officials and policymakers. None have been subject to disruption or allegations of partisan imbalance. The list of guests with whom Batten students have interacted include Governors Robert McDonald, Terry McCall, one a Republican, one a Democrat, Senators Jim Webb, Mark Warner, and Tim Kaine. Previous Republican Democratic representatives of the 5th District, Robert Hurt and Tom Perriello, and many other members, from Robert Scott and Jerry Connolly on the left, Tom Davis and Eric Cantor on the right. Our Batten students have also engaged on grounds with presidential candidates as well as former Supreme Court justices, top intelligence, defense, and NGO leaders. This is a central part of what we do here at the Batten School and at the University of Virginia. As public servants, we challenge assumptions. We listen to views frequently, especially to those with whom we disagree, and then we search for common ground. As dean, I remain deeply committed to the principles of academic freedom and civil discourse which guide such efforts. We've made every possible effort tonight to ensure the fairness of these exchanges so central to our democracy. I will vigorously oppose any efforts to deny you these rights. When we were approached by the College Republicans to co-host this event, each of us here at the Batten School viewed this as both an academic opportunity and part of our public responsibility. Our students are preparing to lead and shape public policy. Our nation desperately needs to find more ways to hold a civil, fact-based conversation about community, state, national, and international issues. We are thrilled tonight to be joined by audience members from locations throughout the Commonwealth, in addition to Batten School students and guests of the candidates. Access to this debate has been limited only by the fire marshal who has capped this, our school's largest room, at 180 seats. As moderator, I invite questions from all of you. Submit them with your name and topic on the cards or pieces of paper provided if you have not done so already. In an effort to ensure fairness, questioners' cards will be selected by the staff sitting behind me. I'll reserve the right to ensure that your questions have been responded to directly with follow-ups when I deem necessary. But I ask and expect that each of you, my fellow community members, is simply what my mother used to call good manners. Please refrain from shouting, clapping, cheering, and booing. This is our largest classroom. We do not, and I will not, tolerate actions that violate the rights of others present to hear and be heard. Since we're in a pretty crowded room, not on a tiered floor, please don't wave any signs if you have one in your pocket. Please don't shout or clap while the candidates are speaking. We'll begin with 2-minute opening statements, then we'll pose questions to the candidates in order. Each candidate will have 90 seconds to respond. respond directly to the first candidate's answer or to provide whatever information they care to. Now, let's begin with a warm welcome to our three candidates, Delegate Nick Freitas, Chairman Corey Stewart, and Bishop E.W. Jackson.
Gabriel later took the name Jackson, was born into slavery. That was my great-grandfather. A few years later, my great-grandmother, Eliza, also born into slavery in Orange County, Virginia. My grandfather was born there. Now, little did they know that while they came here under the most horrendous circumstances, they were called into the greatest experiment in human freedom that the world has ever known. And that their great-grandson and the children coming after me would experience more opportunity and more hope and more privilege and more possibility to fulfill their God-given potential than they would ever experience anywhere else on the face of the earth. I love this country, and I'm running for the United States Senate because I believe that the privileges and the possibilities and the opportunities that have been bequeathed to me, in spite of the imperfections of our country, are worth passing on to you and worth arguing about to persuade your fellow students that America is indeed a noble nation, that we were birthed into the horrendous circumstances that the whole world was in, subjugation. Remember, our founding fathers were born into a situation in which one person had control over everything and everybody and all property. They gave us something better. I want to fight to make sure that we give that to you and to your children's children, and that you become convinced and your fellow students become convinced that America is indeed the greatest experiment in human freedom in the history of mankind, and that the constitutional republic that we've been given provides more freedom and opportunity than anything that's ever existed on the face of the earth. Yes, while we may disagree on some issues, that legacy is worth fighting for. I want to be a member of the United States Senate to fight for your future and for the future of those who will come after you. Thank you,
Mr. Jackson. All right, now we're going to shift gears and begin with some questions. We'll start with the first question to Delegate Freitas. He'll have 2 minutes to answer the question. The other two candidates will then have, you'll have 90 seconds. The other two candidates will have 60 seconds to respond. We'll begin with a question from Greer Kelly from Charlottesville, Virginia. Many of us believe that Congress is currently failing to address our greatest public policy challenges. What previous experiences would make you an effective lawmaker, and what strategies would you use to be effective if elected?
So, obviously, I currently serve in the state legislature, and so we face a lot of the similar challenges. Obviously, some things are different, but a lot of the mechanics are very similar. A lot of the issues and a lot of the fundamental questions that we have to answer, that we have to work through, are pretty much identical to what you would see within the United States Congress. One of the things that I want to point out is that, again, once we get past the vitriol that often happens in campaigns, and we actually sit down and we're able to just talk together on identifying what the problem is and then identifying what the solution is, all of a sudden talking about the process becomes a whole lot easier. And I'll give you an example of this. I carried the bill on civil asset forfeiture reform this year in the General Assembly. It's unfortunate to get all the way as far as it should have, but it's got to be some way. I have the Tea Party, the Family Foundation, and the ACLU who are all standing there advocating on behalf of that bill. And one of the things I found that is sorely lacking in American political discourse these days is I believe very deeply in my political philosophy and policy positions that derive from that. And I expect everybody to have different beliefs with respect to that. But when we sit down and we talk, we can spend all of our time talking about the 10 things we disagree on, or we can spend our time talking about the 1 or 2 things that we do agree on. And once we get past the vitriol and the rhetoric, and we just focus on, if we both agree that there is a problem, that there is a needed solution, and we can focus on what the end state looks like instead of getting completely torn down into the process and the campaign aspect of it, you can't arrive at solutions. It's one of the reasons why, even though I have A ratings from every single conservative organization out there, I've been endorsed by members of the Green Party. It's not because I all of a sudden decided to compromise on a core issue. It was because I found what we agreed on, and then we focused on that, and I happened to be a part of the process.
Thank
and we
you.
Got the legislation passed.
Chairman Stewart?
You know what the most useless language in the English language is? I submitted a bill. Who cares? What matters is whether you got the job done. Now, there are 3 chairmen in Northern Virginia who are countywide elected. I'm one of them. The other 2 are Democrats. It's a county of 465,000 residents. It's 55% minority. and I'm the only Republican who's been able to win countywide or Prince William County or anywhere in Northern Virginia for that matter since 2009. And I have governed as a hardcore conservative. I became the first and led the nation's toughest crackdown on illegal immigration. I became the first county to eliminate the concealed carry permit fee. And just recently, and we're going to get this accomplished, we'll become the first in Virginia to place retired police officers in each of our 94 schools. We're going to get that done. That is how I get elected. That's how I'm the only Republican to get elected, because I have a knack, I have an understanding of how to get things accomplished, and that's why I get the vote. Not just Republicans, but independents, and even some Democrats.
Thank you, Chairman Stewart. Bishop Jackson.
You know, most people in political life, which I never call myself a politician, but most people in political life are thermometers, not thermostats. That is, they try to figure out where everybody stands and then reflect that. But that's not leadership. I think leadership requires seeing where we are and where we need to go and trying to persuade people that this is the direction in which we ought to move. So one of the things I plan to do is to be a leader in the United States Senate. Not whether Mitch McConnell gives me a position of leadership or not, to persuade people that the ideas I have are right. For example, I have an idea that September ought to be declared Celebration of American History Month, because that's the month that our Constitution was voted upon. And we need to re-teach our people about our history and its nobility. Yes, it's not perfect, but there's much there to admire. I want to be a not only a leader in the Senate, but I think we need cultural leadership, because we've got to persuade people to begin to look at things differently in order to get politics to reflect a different set of values. So when I go, I intend to immediately start to try to persuade my colleagues and persuade you and the people who vote for me and those who didn't vote for me that we need to start to approach our problems in a different way.
Thank you, Bishop Jackson. Our next question will direct first to Chairman Stewart. This question comes to us from Matthew Cuser from Fredericksburg, Virginia. And the issue is transportation. Those of us living off I-95 face a daily struggle needing to use a roadway incapable of supporting the amount of traffic it has. President Trump has promised to improve our infrastructure. Do you agree with the President on using federal dollars to improve our infrastructure, such as I-95? Or should it primarily be left up to the states?
In 2013, the General Assembly passed the biggest tax increase in Virginia history. And they did it with the promise that all of the funds that would be raised by that tax would be used to construct roads around the Commonwealth of Virginia. Just a few weeks ago, 2 weeks ago in fact, the General Assembly, including my colleague here to my right, voted in favor of a bill, HB 1539, that took $500 million out of road construction in Virginia that was promised for road construction and is giving it to the failed DC metro system. That's not how to lead, folks. I know how to lead. Here in Prince William, my county, Prince William County, I've been leading the biggest road construction program in the Commonwealth of Virginia, even larger than Fairfax County, which is the county of twice the size of Prince William. Yes, I do believe that the federal government does have some responsibilities in building up the interstate system. It never would have been built if it hadn't been for the Eisenhower administration and those in the 1950s who looked ahead and realized that the United States needed a modern infrastructure system, both for national security and for our economy to grow. The fact of the matter is that I-81 in particular is overstressed. We've got traffic coming all the way down the East Coast from Maine to Florida coming down 81. It is used as a national highway. It's not just the responsibility of Virginians to pay for that. It's a national asset, and it needs to be improved. And so, yes, I would be in favor of supporting, and I will be supporting President Trump's bill, legislation, to use federal funding to improve I-81 and I-95.
Thank you, Chairman Stewart. Bishop Jackson, you have 60 seconds.
Well, first of all, let me just mention that I tell people all the time who have real problems with President Trump, don't pay attention to his tweets, pay attention to his actions. And I think President Trump is absolutely right. We have a major infrastructure problem in our country, and yes, it is a responsibility even under the Constitution, which gives Congress the ability to regulate interstate commerce, and our road systems are part of interstate commerce. I mean, you can't do interstate commerce without a decent road system. When we got bridges collapsing, and we got major problems on our roads, certainly the federal government has a responsibility to do something. And yes, I think that the states in some cases, and I think here in Virginia in some cases, when money is appropriated for these purposes, they don't always quite seem to go where they're supposed to go. That really is a matter for the states to handle, but the federal government does have a responsibility to make sure that we have interstate commerce functioning properly, and our road system is part of that.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Delegate Freitas, you have 6 seconds.
So to answer the question, yeah, the federal government does have a limited role to play with respect to transportation, a larger transportation infrastructure, which is clearly not just roads, right? It's a whole multitude of various transportation businesses. But having said that, one of the biggest problems I have with the way the federal government currently operates itself is one, and it never seems to really peruse Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution to focus on its enumerated powers. And two, I'm tired of money constantly leaving the state, leaving the locality, going to the federal government, being run through a huge federal bureaucracy, and then a fraction of the money being sent back with a number of strings attached. Does anybody think that's a good recipe for effective and efficient transportation infrastructure spending? I certainly don't think it is. I think the more money that we actually leave at the local and state level, the more you're going to find transportation solutions which actually service the people in those communities. Because the communities facing, or the challenges facing transportation in Southwest are not the challenges facing Northern Virginia. So the limited role the federal government has with respect to some issues with harbors, with interstates, sure, that's fine. But as much as possible, give control back to the states and the localities to be able to spend that money in a way that actually makes sense for the locality and the population that is using it.
Thank you, Delegate Freitas. Our next question is directed to Bishop Jackson. You'll have 90 seconds. Question comes from Connor Byron from Northampton County out on the Eastern Shore. The question is about climate change and sea level rise. What policies do you support to mitigate the damage that will be caused by sea level rise over the next century to important industrial and residential areas on Virginia's coastline, especially on the Eastern Shore?
Well, first of all, look, in spite of what the mainstream media would tell you, there are differences of opinion among scientists on the degree to which climate change poses a major problem for the future of the world. I happen to have the view that the climate is like human beings. You know, we are homeostatic beings. That means that we have a tendency, our bodies, to adjust to the environment around us. I just don't happen to be one of those people who believe that driving SUVs is going to cause the planet to spin off its axis. But on the other hand, I think that we ought to be focused on stewardship of our environment rather than what amounts to ultimate control of private property and people's ability to build and for us to grow economically. Stewardship means clean air, clean water, making sure that we preserve the beauty of our environment, which I think every American can agree on, whether you're coming from the left or the right. But some of these proposals coming out of the EPA and some of these efforts to over-regulate and control people's private property, I just think are misplaced. I would change the name of the EPA to the Department of Environmental Stewardship and focus on educating the American people, most of whom want to be responsible with regard to our environment.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Delegate Freitas?
I think when we get into the whole topic of anthropogenic global warming, because that ends up being the issue, right? Unfortunately, we can't just look at what the climate is doing, and we can't just look at the actual effects that it's having on something like the coastline. It instantly gets used as political football on whether or not you subscribe to certain larger policy objectives with respect to reducing carbon emissions, et cetera, et cetera. To answer this specific question, whether it's anthropogenic global warming or whether it's sea levels raising for some other reason doesn't mean a whole lot to the person that's actually contending with the issue. Right? One of the things that we need to do is again, don't use issues as a political football. If we have sea level rise that is affecting the Eastern Shore, is affecting Virginia Beach and the Virginia coast, what are the proper mechanisms that we can use in order to combat that? And I think there is a role, a limited role, again, with the federal government, especially when we're talking about a huge naval base down in Norfolk, on how do we go there and ensure that we reinforce the shoreline, and what is the proper dredging mechanisms that we have to use. But once again, if we reinforce private property rights and people actually have an incentive to take care of their own property, combined with allowing state and local officials to be able to develop solutions that work best for their own shore erosion problems, that's where you're actually going to get the solutions that actually work and address the issue instead of turning the issue itself into some sort of political football that politicians fight about. So, again,
thank you. Delegate Freitas. Chairman Stewart.
I believe that the theory of man-made climate change is a hoax. Look, we have a lot of environmental issues, but they're worldwide. The Paris Accord limited carbon emissions in the United States and Western Europe, Canada, Australia, and Japan, but guess who did not limit? The Chinese did not limit the Indians, did not limit the huge economic growth that is going on in the Far East. The fact of the matter is that the Paris Accord and other international agreements which would have limited carbon emissions would also have limited the growth of our economy. So I support President Trump in withdrawing from the Paris Accord. But here's something, and this all goes back down to the main issue which I brought up at the beginning, and that is free speech. You know, if you go onto this campus or any other campus across this country and you say they don't believe in climate change, you're berated, you're ridiculed, you're called a denier. The only way we can get to the truth is through free speech, and that includes on this issue.
Thank you, Chairman Stewart.
Thank you.